Understand why some people respond differently from others to the same foods, beverages, supplements that they consume. Now, I'm not claiming that genetics is everything, because as you saw with the example that Dr. Mosafarian showed, certainly when it comes to an infection or an outbreak, we're not really talking about, you know, some people respond more than others to infection. So a lot of that really elegant epidemiological work done by John Snow really demonstrated that, you know, when it comes to outbreaks, we can very rapidly pinpoint the cause. But I know when he showed that example, you guys must have thought, wow, what a busy guy this John Snow is. He's an epidemiologist and the head of the Night's Watch. I thought the same thing too, so. Four or five people don't watch Game of Thrones, but you know, look it up later. I also thought I would share with you some of the translational activities that we've been doing in terms of our startup company, also called Nutrigenomix, which is a UofT startup company, and really we developed this genetic test for personalized nutrition. Now, a lot of the excitement and interest in this whole area started to take off just over a decade ago with the first draft sequence of the Human Genome Project. There's a lot of interest and excitement all across the life sciences. Really, all of the disciplines wanted to know how could we make use of this newfound wealth of information. And shortly after, science hailed genetic human genetic variation as the breakthrough discovery of the year. We found out that genetic variations throughout the genome were much more common than we had originally thought, and again, garnered a lot more interest in trying to understand how we can use this information to better understand health and disease. So, let's just be friends. It's my DNA, isn't it? And you can see here she has a copy of the genome report. Now, before you think, well, how ridiculous it might be for people to date a mate based on their genetics, there's actually some companies out there. This is one called Scientific Match. And they say, why pay matchmaker prices when you can have chemistry? The science supposedly behind this is related to people's ability to detect pheromones, which is actually a legitimate field of science. But we just know in modern times that's not what most people use to find their mates. They were having this special around Valentine's Day, half off, for February. For only $995, you can get this lifetime membership. You would think that if it works, yeah, you'd need a lifetime membership. First person that comes up. And you can see here, there's a bunch of benefits here. Chances are increased that you'll love the natural body fragrance of your matches. Number four here is women have a much lower chance of cheating in their exclusive relationships. Nothing but men. Yes, that's it. I don't think there's a test for that yet. So these are obviously, you know, kind of the commercial applications that operate on, let's say, the fringe. But there are legitimate fields of science that really try to understand how we can use this information in a meaningful and real way. This is just, you know, kind of my working definition of the science of nutrigenomics, really using information about the human genome as well as various tools and technologies and genotyping to understand how nutrition impacts our health as well as performance. So I've added performance here recently because one of my graduate students is looking at the performance-enhancing effects of caffeine. A lot of athletes take it, it benefits some, it doesn't others. It actually may impair performance in some athletes, but oftentimes an athlete will take a bunch of supplements, and if the performance improves, they might falsely ascribe that to the caffeine when it could be due to something else. So we're actually demonstrating that using a randomized controlled clinical trial. Now, when we look at the experimental approach that we take in this field, we can think of really two sides of a coin. On the one hand, we can look at how diet can affect gene structure and function. Nutrients can upregulate or downregulate the expression of all kinds of genes. They can cause epigenetic modifications that can be inherited to the offspring. The flip side of that, and really what the focus of our research program is understanding how variations in genes affect the way we respond to dietary factors. So genes code for proteins that affect the rate of absorption, the distribution, the cellular uptake, and the breakdown of just about everything we consume. So it's one thing to know if a person drinks, you know, 4 cups of coffee a day versus 1 cup a day. It's another thing to know, well, how do they metabolize the bioactives and how much actually lingers in their system and reaches the target cells of interest. Now, another element of this bottom arrow here is before a gene or a gene product can even act on a nutrient, genes can also influence the foods that we select. So we heard a lot about this morning, food preferences, things like salt, sugar, and fat. In this review article a number of years ago, identified various kind of touch points on where genetic variation can influence the link between food and health or performance. So genes can affect taste perception, which ultimately influence our preferences, likes and dislikes of certain foods, and what we choose to consume. And when we look at the foods that we have ingested, how are they metabolized? And ultimately how that impacts our risk of chronic disease. Cilantro, here's one that's probably the most polarizing food. I mean, some people just can't stand it. Maybe just a show of hands. How many here can't stand the taste of cilantro? Right? Yeah. Yeah. How many people think like me it's the most delicious fragrant herb ever created? Yeah. So those who have their hands down, they must be thinking, what's wrong with these people? Right? It tastes like soap, it tastes like dirt, it tastes like bugs. And those are the descriptors that cilantro haters describe it. Julia Child, I think, was one who was well-known, you know, culinary expert who thought cilantro was the most horrendous thing ever created by nature. It turns out there's a variation in the gene that codes for an olfactory receptor. So it's really the sense of smell. And we know that flavors are a combination of taste and smell, and so this explains why some people just can't stand the taste of cilantro. We did the study, this was my former graduate students, Lily Maurer, where we identified the prevalence of cilantro disliking among different ethnocultural groups. Not surprisingly, it was the lowest in Latin America, in the Middle East, and the highest in certain Northern European populations. And again, we also confirmed this link between this gene that codes for your sense of smell and explain why some people just can't stand the taste of cilantro. Now, so that's cilantro. So think about, you know, if you're one of those people that just can't stand it versus someone who likes it, that's a pretty strong genetic determinant of whether or not you're ever going to consume that. But what about other aspects of the diet? What about, you know, the extent to which you may like sugar or salt or fat, and could your genes influence how much you seek those versus someone else who just doesn't have the same version of that gene? So that's been an interest of our research program. We know there are basically 5 taste modalities. Fat is a potential 6th taste. We can perceive all the taste modalities pretty much throughout the tongue, some a little bit more intensely than others. But we know that there are genes that code for specific receptors that help us perceive sweetness, sourness, bitterness, and other taste modalities. So we started off in this area. This was work done by one of my former PhD students, Karen Henney, who's also a dietitian, and she identified a variation in a glucose transporter. So this doesn't affect your perception of sweet taste. This affects your region of the brain that regulates appetite. If you recall, I think from Dr. Ludwig's slide, the nucleus accumbens, this is an area where GLUT2 is highly expressed. And it turns out some people have a version of this receptor, or sorry, this transporter, that makes them have impaired transportability. So they just need to consume more sugar to get that same signal in the brain that says, okay, I've had enough sugar, now I can stop. So we identified this in 2 very different populations where this common variation in this glucose transporter predicted to some extent how much sugar individuals consume. So the difference between the 2 groups was something around like 30 grams of sugar per day in 2 different populations. Following up on that, Karen expanded her thesis work to look at variations in the sweet taste receptor. So TAS102, that's the gene that codes for the receptor on the surface of the tongue. So she also found that people who had a different version of that also consume more sugars than others. So there are some people that actually have this, you know, kind of a double hit or a double whammy. So they enjoy the perception of the sweet taste on the surface of the tongue to a greater extent than others, so that makes them consume more sugars. And they also have impaired glucose sensing in the brain. And we found that people who have both those versions actually consume even more sugar. And there's some people that just kind of lucked out and they don't have either version of that gene, and they tend to consume just habitually the lowest amount of sugar. Now, obviously, you know, there are marketing geniuses that work at all these multinational food companies that have ways to make people consume more sugars. Jen told me she was leaving and shouldn't be offended when she walks out, so I'm happy. I can officially say I've been booed and somebody stormed out. I had to storm out so I can use that as a story. So, despite that, and despite the environmental forces that can influence our desire or our consumption habits, right? I mean, how often do you have an awesome dessert offering like you had today? You're obviously, many of you are probably consuming more than you would normally. But under normal conditions, on kind of everyday basis, some people just seek out sugar a little bit more than other people. And this is just an example of sugar. I think we can probably demonstrate this with virtually all other taste modalities. So again, some people that have both versions of those genes, they tend to crave sugar to a greater extent. So when we published our study, this was the front page of the Toronto Star, craving something sweet, blame it on your DNA. Obviously that wasn't the message that we wanted to communicate. Thinking of what Michael said earlier in terms of the responsibility of the media, but you know, headlines, that's what sells newspapers, and this is what they thought was catchy. My friends just spoke fun of me because this was the front page of the Toronto Star and said, UofT nutrition expert, and then my name is buried somewhere in the middle. So I like to do experiments at home. N of 2. This is not how they dress for school every day. This happens to be Halloween. This is my daughter Ashley, who's telling everyone she's dressed as Vanessa Ives from Penny Dreadful. Fans of it. It's a horror show, basically. She's never watched it, but she's just heard the name of the character. So my daughter actually doesn't really care much for sweets. So when she was first born, we're like, what are all these parents complaining about their kids always asking for sugar and candy? She just never cared for it. She actually likes salad, broccoli, fish, all that kind of nice stuff. Then our son came along. As you can see, he's a little happier about Halloween than she is. He's like a hawk. He can spot a jelly bean from like 2 miles away. And sure enough, he has the elevated risk of a combination of both the sweet taste and the glucose transporter, whereas my daughter doesn't have either. I happen to be heterozygote, and so I know myself, I tend to have a bit of a craving based on the GLUT2, and I just try to be, again, this is now down to an N of 1, try to be a bit more mindful in terms of, especially after Halloween and the leftover candy, of not bringing any more than just one little chocolate, because I know that my GLUT2 will be talking to me at about 3 p.m, saying it's time to saturate me. Now, one of the questions that I often get from some of my more traditional card-carrying nutrition colleagues is, you know, why bother with genetics and genomics? We're trying to understand things like the obesity and diabetes epidemic over the past 20-somewhat years. Again, as Dr. Mosafari mentioned, the genetics of our population has not changed in that time. And I certainly agree with that. Clearly, there was some environmental shift. Greater abundance of, you know, highly palatable, energy-dense, nutrient-poor foods, as well as an environment that just encourages less physical activity. But obviously, not everyone has become obese, and not everyone has developed diabetes. So we think that perhaps with that environmental change, that may have unmasked the genetic potential that some individuals had to develop obesity and diabetes. So that's kind of one way to look at it. Another way is if you trace the path from virtually any nutritional factor and any health outcome, if there have been enough observational studies, epidemiological studies, you tend to see this heterogeneity of response. Now, there's a number of reasons for a lot of these inconsistencies, issues around study design and so forth, but a major factor is the genetics of the populations that are being studied. So you pick your nutritional factor, you pick your health outcome, it's coffee and heart disease, fiber and colon cancer, right? Some studies showing that fiber increases the risk of precancerous lesions in the colon. Studies published in the New England Journal of Medicine had to be stopped prematurely. Sodium and blood pressure. Some people that go on a low sodium diet, blood pressure goes up. Right? Saturated fat and blood lipids, same thing. We used to call them outliers, right? Try to figure out how to get rid of them from the statistical analysis. But it turns out that, you know, more and more we're starting to see these so-called outliers, and in some cases they're not a trivial proportion of the population. In some cases, 10, 20, or even 30% of the population will respond in the opposite direction that we anticipated. And this has been demonstrated in, you know, controlled metabolic conditions, where usually they get a bunch of oftentimes students, they pay them quite well, they lock them up in a room and monitor every morsel of food that they consume, and sure enough, we see that there is this opposite response, if you will. So it's okay if, obviously, if the nutritional advice that we give is improving our health outcome, and perhaps not a big deal if the advice isn't doing anything, but what about if the advice that we're giving may in fact cause harm? And if there's a way of identifying these people, is there an alternate strategy that we can then consider? So obviously, one size just does not fit all. Now, some of you may be arguing, well, genetic testing is no better than seeing this old lady here. And I think it's important to clarify that really, to some extent, there are two different conversations that are happening here. A lot of skeptics of genetic testing, and I think the issue is really around discussions of disease risk prediction. And so when it comes to the common forms of cardiovascular disease, diabetes, we thought that genetics and all those GWAS studies were going to solve the problem and say, okay, these are the genetic markers. It turns out those studies have also been inconsistent. Some genetic markers are associated with type 2 diabetes only under certain environmental conditions. In other environmental conditions, it's the opposite allele, the opposite form of that gene. Just like diet alone does not predict as common chronic disease, these common genetic markers also on their own does not. Where I think there's an opportunity are the modifier genes or the metabolic genes. So these are the genes that alone do not impact your risk of a disease, but they affect the way you respond to whatever it is that you ingest. So common example is something like lactose intolerance, right? So if you have the gene that makes you have an impaired ability to break down lactose, that gene alone is not going to cause, you know, gastrointestinal problems, diarrhea, and all that. But having that gene and drinking milk, well, you know, then you're in trouble. So some of coined this term, the so-called Angelina Jolie effect, where if you recall, based on a positive genetic test, she had a bilateral prophylactic mastectomy. What ended up happening when this was popularized, or the fact that she did this was publicized, was a lot of women went, out in droves to get tested. But the fact is, the genetic test that she tested positive for is a rare form of breast cancer. I mean, rare, it accounts for about 10% of breast cancer cases, right? BRCA1 and BRCA2, right? But about 90% of breast cancer cases have nothing to do with this genetic marker. So if you're a woman, you went out and got this test and you got a negative result, to some extent that's false assurance, because the odds are you may develop breast cancer, because 90% of those cases have nothing to do with this genetic marker. So again, in terms of disease-associated genes, this has been successful for the so-called rare conditions. But when it comes to the common chronic diseases, not so much. Opportunities are really in the modifier genes. And when we think about genes that affect, you know, the metabolic response, how much of whatever it is that you're exposed to sticks around in your system, reaches target cells of interest.
Weight management, a lot of interest, of course, in this whole field. Again, when it comes to trying to predict the risk of obesity, none of these genetic markers are really reliable, except for the rare forms of obesity that you see in infancy. And these are cases where, you know, a child has a rare form of a leptin deficiency and they just can't stop eating. But in terms of the metabolic response, this is actually a result from the pounds lost study that Dr. Ludwig referred to. And it turns out in terms of secondary analyses, so it was a fairly well-designed study, even though not everyone met the target goals, there were still some people that ended up eating more of a high-protein diet versus the low-protein diet. And it turns out while the diet itself wasn't a very strong predictor of how much fat mass was lost after a two-year, those who had the AA version of the FTO gene, those are the ones that seem to be most responsive to a high-protein diet. Whereas if you have the T version of the gene, it really doesn't matter whether you have a high-protein diet or a low-protein diet. You're not really going to respond. So here's an example where this is recommendations that perhaps could be customized to individuals who have this genetic marker. So this was a two-year RCT. One of my undergraduate students wanted to replicate this in an observational study. This is unpublished data from our group, but you see the same pattern. In fact, this is now in an East Asian cohort. Because you often hear of this argument in the field of genetics, well, most research is done on Northern Europeans, what about other ethnic groups? Well, here we see the same thing. Even though the frequency of these different genetic variants might differ between East Asians and Caucasians, you see the same thing, that those who have the AA version and are on a low-protein diet, they have a higher BMI and, more importantly, a higher waist circumference. And you can see here almost a 10-centimeter difference in terms of those who are on a low-protein versus a high-protein only when they have this genetic marker. So again, replicated in two distinct populations and also in different ethnic groups. So just to draw on one of the examples that we've worked on from over a decade ago now, and it's really the link between coffee and cardiovascular disease. Some of you have seen me present this work before. It's been now 10 years that we've published this. Dozens of studies looking at this association, results all over the map. Some of the more recent studies that suggest a decrease effect show this U-shaped or a J-shaped association, suggesting that moderate consumption might be protective, and as you increase risk, as you increase consumption, risk starts to go up. Our interest, of course, was trying to identify the genetic markers that can help us predict if coffee is good for you or bad for you. Now, when you look at a cup of coffee, it's a fairly complex beverage, all kinds of bioactives. Some of the polyphenols that have antioxidant properties might be good for you, been associated with lower risk of a number of chronic diseases. Other things like the diterpenoids that raise LDL cholesterol, the bad cholesterol, not so good. We focused on caffeine and asked the question, is caffeine a component in coffee that might trigger a heart attack? This is just the chemical structure of caffeine. It is the most widely consumed stimulant in the world. Many of us can't get our day started without one. And usually at this time of day, I can see some people who can use a cup right now. I'm not pointing to anyone. It used to be that we couldn't add caffeine to anything other than a cola beverage until the natural health products regulations came into effect. And you can find caffeinated water, caffeinated brownies. These are caffeinated gummy bears, energy gummies, even caffeinated potato chips, NRG potato chips. The latest creation is this, caffeinated peanut butter. This was actually developed by a couple of frat buddies as the ultimate hangover cure. So you can see here it's got some protein, some electrolytes, and some caffeine. Energy drinks are just surging in popularity. This is just one brand. It was actually taken off the shelves of 7-Eleven stores. Parents weren't too happy with their little kids coming home with a can of cocaine. If you can't read the top there, it says the legal alternative. It's spelled in white powder here, as you can see. So clearly the marketing geniuses are catering to the risk-taking behaviors of the youth and adolescents. This little can of cocaine has 280 milligrams of caffeine. It's about the equivalent of, you know, almost 3 cups of coffee. And, you know, as much as manufacturers of energy drinks argue, well, you shouldn't really regulate us any differently than coffee, because certain cups from Starbucks have even more than that. But I think there's a difference between a hot beverage that's sipped slowly over time versus these cold drinks that often chugged. So in terms of the peak plasma concentration, clearly these cause that to happen much more than coffee. Now, when we look at how caffeine is broken down in the body, it's broken down almost exclusively by this enzyme. Won't get into the chemistry. The bottom line is this catalyzes the rate-limiting breakdown or the detoxification of caffeine. And when we look at the gene that codes for this enzyme, there's a common variation that has a profound effect on enzyme activity or inducibility, as shown here on the y-axis. So if you've inherited the A version of both your parents, you essentially have a fourfold higher rate of getting rid of caffeine, more so than someone who has even a single copy of this. So we reason that if caffeine is a component in coffee that might trigger a heart attack, we would expect the slow metabolizers to be at a higher risk, right? Because it sticks around in the system longer. These people get rid of it very rapidly and efficiently, so it's not likely to cause any harm. Now, when we looked at our entire population without taking genetics into account, we found that those who drank 4 more cups a day was associated with a higher risk of a heart attack, 36%. But the real question was, is this increased risk due to caffeine? If so, we would expect the slow metabolizers to be at a higher risk. And when we separated the population, that's exactly what we found, that the fast metabolizers, moderate consumption now looks to be protective. Remember, some studies showed this pattern, this U-shaped pattern, where moderate consumption was protective. What we think might be happening here is because the fast metabolizers can efficiently get rid of the bad caffeine, that might unmask some of the beneficial effects of the polyphenols, the antioxidants, and the other goodies that are found in a cup of coffee. The slow metabolizers here, even 2 to 3 cups a day, is associated with a significantly higher risk. When we go back to our entire population, the reason why we didn't see anything with 2 to 3 cups a day here is these people are a mixture of the slow metabolizers that have a higher risk and the fast metabolizers that seem to be protected. But when you mix them together and don't take genetics into account, you would conclude that, you know, coffee doesn't do anything. So we published this in JAMA just over 10 years ago now, and it was the kind of thing that got quite a bit of media attention. This is the front page of the London Times in the UK, why 2 cups of coffee can damage your heart. And the headline on the inside, again to sell newspapers, was "Gene that could make your next coffee your last." So remember that coming back from the health break if you don't all return. It wasn't until a couple of years later that another group in Italy essentially replicated these findings, but instead of looking at risk of a heart attack, they looked at the risk of developing hypertension. And even though in Italy their cup sizes are a little bit different, and they do other things when they eat and drink, apparently. Nevertheless, you see the same pattern. The fast metabolizers seem to be protected, the slow metabolizers higher risk. When they did not take genetics into account, they concluded that coffee does nothing to hypertension. And this is largely why a lot of regulatory bodies don't make any firm recommendations on coffee or caffeine in heart disease or hypertension, because they say the findings are all over the map. And if there was a clear effect, it should light up. And last year, another group showed that similar pattern in terms of prediabetes. Only the fast metabolizers seem to be protected when it comes to coffee. The slow metabolizers, no benefit. And we have some unpublished data with some of our collaborators looking at kidney health, glomerular filtration rate. And you can see, again, the slow metabolizers, increasing cups of coffee is positively associated with GFR, indicating greater impaired kidney function, whereas the fast metabolizers, this effect is completely blunted. So again, when we think of coffee and health, slow metabolizers have a higher risk of a heart attack, hypertension, prediabetes, and kidney disease. So when it comes to giving recommendations, clearly, again, one size does not fit all, but the abundance of evidence is suggesting for all these different health outcomes that the slow metabolizers really need to limit their intake to a greater extent. So how do we balance the advice that we give to individuals with the public health recommendations that we give to everybody? Well, just last year, near November, the U.S. came out there with their guidelines and recommendations. And then this article from the Washington Post came out and said why their recommendations that you can drink up to 4 or 5 cups a day might actually be wrong. And he said why that might only be true for half the population. So clearly this reporter does read JAMA and Journal of Hypertension and all the other publications, which is great. And he quoted this epidemiologist from UCLA who noted there are spectacular metabolic differences in people, and to expect that coffee will have the same health effects on everyone is absurd. So that, I think, sums it up nicely. But also, he interviewed one of the panel members that set the recommendations, and she noted that, unfortunately, because genetic testing is expensive and rarely done, most people have little idea which gene variant they carry. Now, fair enough, right? I mean, you can't give recommendations based on knowledge that most people just don't have. But some have argued, well, perhaps we should be protecting the most vulnerable in our population. Maybe set the recommendations for, 2 cups a day. The fast metabolizers will actually might benefit for 2 cups a day. With 4, they don't benefit, but it just doesn't increase the risk. So here's an example where you can use genetic information to set policy for everybody until the accessibility and availability of genetic information does become more widespread. And certainly the cost of genetic testing is really coming down. So in terms of this kind of information, there's a proliferation of these consumer genetic testing companies that say people have a right to their genetic information because it will empower them to lead healthier lifestyle choices. Now, the vast majority of these companies, first of all, you'll notice some of them have end dates, right? So they've either gone bankrupt, like Sciona and MyGene, or they've been acquired and no longer offer their genetic testing services. Fortunately, no end date here just yet. The majority of them, again, just market directly to consumers. So you can go online, go to the website, pull out your credit card, and offer this. So a lot of them cater to kind of direct marketing to consumers. Some of them use testimonials. Here's a company from some Eastern European country. I don't recall which one. Male supermodel. I've always thought that I have good genes, but now I know. Clearly not the modesty gene, but well, we thought, that's an interesting question. We don't know what would happen if you give people their genetic information. So we decided to put this to the test. And we thought, on the one hand, someone might say, I have the gene, increases my risk of something, I'm going to watch what I eat. The flip side might be this, kind of fatalistic or deterministic view. I have the gene, there's nothing I can do, pass me the remote and leave me alone. Now, this type of scenario really relates to the disease risk prediction genes that I talked about. Because when it comes to the metabolic genes, there is something you can do, right? If you're a heavy coffee drinker and you find out you're a slow metabolizer, you can cut back, right? If you find out you have the gene for salt-sensitive hypertension, you could limit your sodium intake. So we wanted to test this in the context of those metabolic or modifier genes. So we did this using a randomized controlled clinical trial. And at first, we reported just the attitudes, perceptions, and motivation to change. And we found that, surprisingly, those who got the DNA-based dietary advice actually claimed to understand the recommendations to a greater extent. It was a bit of a surprise, but some had argued that people don't understand genetics and genetic information. It's too complicated. They just won't get it. We found the total opposite. And we think that it really depends on how that information is communicated. If you give a consumer just a raw readout, A, C, G, T, C, C, and say, here you go, of course they're not going to understand that. But if you tell them, your genetics show us that you're a slow metabolizer, you break down caffeine slowly, you need to limit your intake, they'll be like, oh yeah, I get that. So they actually understood it to a greater extent. And we think that's really probably just an ego thing. right? Because you're telling them, this is your DNA, this is your personalized advice, they just happen to pay more attention. And the only difference between the DNA-based report and the generic report is just one line that tells them what their genetic result is. They look virtually identical. So it's not like we're comparing some fancy, glossy output to, you know, Health Canada's ugly, microscopic, you know, report. So they also indicated a greater motivation to change. Did that actually result in behavior change? We found that indeed they did. So we randomized people to receive either the DNA-based dietary advice or the generic advice, and then followed them up 3 months later and 1 year later. And again, those who received the DNA-based dietary advice improved their the compliance to the recommendations. Specifically, those who got the gene for salt-sensitive hypertension, they're the ones who lowered their sodium intake to a greater extent and maintained that after 1 year later. And the reduction in sodium was somewhere between, I think, 200 to 300 milligrams. And not only did they lower their sodium intake, but it was the right group that needed to lower their sodium intake, because they're the ones that have that genetic marker. So we've shown that instead of just giving people the same generic advice, you can actually motivate people to follow the recommendations that you give them, because you're personalizing that to them. They may have gotten other advice that said, well, you know what, you're lucky when it comes to caffeine, you're a fast metabolizer, you know, you can drink up to 4 cups a day, but you really need to focus on sodium. So it's kind of like, you know, picking your battles in terms of how that person responds metabolically. So again, got a little bit of media attention. I don't know why this was a headline, genes really do hold the key to fitting in your genes. Had nothing to do with weight management, but nevertheless, it demonstrates that if you can actually adhere to the recommendations that it motivates you, you're actually more likely to stick to a healthier eating habit. So we, again, through a startup company at UofT, developed this genetic test to be used only by healthcare professionals, not direct to consumer. And we decided to do that for a number of reasons. We think it's the most responsible way, first of all, to deliver this kind of genetic information. And we think that the healthcare professional can explain the benefits and limitations of a test. It's not for everyone, right? If you have a patient or a client who doesn't drink much coffee, already is kind of on a low-sodium diet, doesn't eat much processed foods, there's nothing that the genetic test is going to tell them that they're not already doing. So that's someone who's not really a candidate. The healthcare professional can address some concerns that some people have around genetic testing. There could be some more accountability to the healthcare professional. Other options for testing, and lastly, just better understanding of instructions, right? If you deal with the public directly, some people just don't understand the instructions. Here's a DNA test. Doctor, I'm having a little difficulty with the cheek swab. Now, I used to say, oh, he got the wrong cheek, but some of you might say, no, he actually has the right cheek. There was a question earlier here, but hey, I'm just the messenger here, so I... In case you were wondering how you get your microbiome analyzed, it's not from the saliva, I can tell you that now. So there was a meta-analysis that came up recently showing that some of these RCTs on probiotics really don't demonstrate a whole lot of efficacy. I know that was a question that was raised earlier this morning. And so this was work done by the University of Copenhagen, and this is, again, kind of the headlines, probiotics, just a waste of money. It turns out that most people end up gravitating or reverting back to a particular microbial profile. Now, it doesn't mean that the microbiome is insignificant. I think it plays a profound effect on metabolism. But at the end of the day, the evidence shows that some people tend to have more of a set microbiome, and perhaps you need other kinds of probiotics to really shift them in any meaningful way. So here's a study that shows that the host genetics, right, the genetics of the individual determines what bacteria choose to colonize in your gut. And more recently, a study, again, using twins demonstrated that, identical twins have more of a similar microbial profile than fraternal twins. So just to wrap up, is DNA-based dietary advice ready for prime time? Maybe 7 or 8 years ago, I would have said no. It's still in its infancy. But I think now the time is right. Many of the studies have been replicated, demonstrated in different ethnic groups. We've used RCTs. The information is actionable and personalizable. And there's just greater consumer awareness and demand for this kind of information. This is just a report by the Institute of the Future that found that about a third of consumers would focus on personalized nutrition, and that a sizable segment would be making day-to-day decisions on what to eat based on their genetic makeup. We might not be fully there just yet, but I think we've come a long way. And I think consumers are going to see headlines more like this: genetics may define diets of the future. We already have products on the supermarket shelves that are developed for specific genotypes, so the concept being futuristic is not really the case. It's actually here today. You may be familiar with Coca-Cola's, share a Coke with your name, and you can have these bins with all these names. I searched for Ahmed, and believe it or not, it doesn't exist. But they can allow you to customize it. So I entered my name and my preferred brand and or the type with the sweetener, Coke Zero, and sure enough, I can customize it. Now, I can tell you Coca-Cola doesn't really care about whether your name is on a bottle. This is really their foray into this whole area of personalized nutrition and just testing the waters to see whether or not this concept of personalization can be marketed on a mass scale. So when you think about some of these vending machines they now have, the combination of flavors and sweeteners or artificial sweeteners, you can have over 100 choices. So it's not impossible to consider just on the back, you enter maybe just with a Bluetooth connection, your genotype, and instead of a flavor or taste, it can tell you how much caffeine or how much of a particular micronutrient. So again, a lot of these companies are just kind of testing the waters to see whether or not this can be done. Pepsi is also collaborating on this project with some designers where they're looking at hydration, and they're working with the Brazilian soccer team, not yet to look at genetics, but just looking at the individual players and how much liquid, fluid they lose in terms of sweating, and within that same volume, how much of the electrolytes they're losing. So two athletes can lose the same volume of sweat, but one can have a lot more electrolytes being lost than another. So the concept, clearly genetics is what's determining those. And right now, the idea is not that, you know, we'll have 3 million different varieties based on how many genetic variants, but just, are you at this end of the spectrum in terms of your requirements, or are you at this end of the spectrum? And this is something that I think we're going to see more and more. So I'll just finish off by thanking the members of my group, some of our funding partners, and I'll leave you with my favorite quote. Even though the term nutrigenomics is fairly new, the concept is quite ancient, and Hippocrates noted over 2,500 years ago that positive health requires a knowledge of man's primary constitution. That's really just an old-fashioned way of saying genotype. And he went on to say, the powers of various foods, both those natural to them and those resulting from human skill, and clearly he was thinking about personalized nutrition. So I'll stop here and thank you for your attention.
I guess if you could shed some light on the concept of set point theory, and I know weight loss and weight maintenance is really multifactorial, so you probably couldn't touch on all the points, but is there any body of research to talk about genetics and how tightly people regulate their weight, and, you know, could there ever be a point where we say, you know, 10% weight loss for some person might be a bit more realistic than, say, you know, 5% or, you know, anything
right. I mean, that's definitely an excellent area of research to pursue. Unfortunately, the majority of research on the genetics of obesity has just focused on trying to identify individual markers, not even considering the environment and other contributors, to outcomes like BMI, waist circumference, you know, body fatness using other measures. And when they've discovered that any of these individual markers aren't really reliable predictors, then they say, okay, well, we got to create gene scores and look at multiple genetic markers. And again, we can only explain, you know, a small proportion of the variation. I think where the research should go is like what you're talking about in terms of response to a particular weight loss regimen, whether or not a person needs to, or, you know, can benefit more on, you know, an extreme caloric reduction, or whether they need to decrease their, have a greater caloric deficit kind of more gradually because of various, you know, biological That's what Dr. Ludwig was referring to. When he says biological, I hear genetic, because that is a major contributor to the biology. But really, the short answer is that type of work has not yet been done, but I think it will be, and it should be.